Hello everybody. So I'm going to start the presentation, and as usual, and the list of topics that I'm going to talk about. I will start with a boring introduction about the specifications related with this work. And as the presentation said, this is an update, so I will follow with a summary of the previous presentation that I gave on 14 this year. I will give a summary of how evolve, or more that how evolve, I will answer the usual questions about how this work was been done this year. I will then explain how all this was tested. And finally, I will explain what is the current status and what is the following tasks to implement in the future. So, everybody knows what GLSL and SPIR-V is. So in OpenGL, you have the high-level shading language that is called GLSL. It's a kind of C-like high-level language. OpenGL also had some language defined on the extensions RB, Vertex, and Farming program, but they were really too low level. They were basically assembly, and several vendors had a specific ones. In my opinion, it was like a mess. So that was one of the reasons the more popular and the default one is GLSL. It was introduced on almost 15 years ago. And one of the things that some vendors didn't like, or some developers didn't like, is that the original shader is included on your program, so it was easy to extract and to get. And in the end, it's a program as any other else. Then it was introduced SPIR-V. SPIR-V is it was introduced initially as just SPIR for OpenCL. And it was, in this case, it was a binary format. Initially, it was based on LLVM. Then, in 2015, SPIR-V was introduced. That was an evolution of that one, and the idea was including it on OpenCL 2.1 and on Vulkan. And in this case, it was not an LLVM IR anymore. So what we have here is that on the same ecosystem, we have OpenGL and we have Vulkan, more or less for the same use case, although in theory OpenGL is more friendly and Vulkan is more low level. But the thing is that there were several applications that are planned to port one to the other, or there are some other applications that would prefer to keep a renderer, an OpenGL renderer and a Vulkan renderer. So the thing is that in those cases, it would be good to have some kind of sharing as much as possible. So what was the first step? The first step was extension called Vulkan GLSL. This extension is not exactly a driver extension. This extension, what defines is what GLSL. The thing is that also Vulkan uses SPIR-V, so the idea is that, or the idea, the thing is that almost no application will go and write directly SPIR-V. At least initially, a lot of applications are planning to use GLSL and doing a conversion, translate from GLSL to SPIR-V. So what this extension defines is which GLSL you are going to use to generate those SPIR-V. In some sense, it was a kind of cleaning up of GLSL. It removed several features, it added some ones, and also tweaked some of others. So in that sense, just GLSL, it was not suitable for Vulkan consumption. And then we have the other side of the mirror, the OpenGL extension, that is the one that I'm going to talk about, that is GLSPIR-V. These extensions has two parts, one for the driver, one for the front end. For the driver, it allows to load SPIR-V modules on OpenGL. And the front end, it also modifies GLSL. Similar to the previous one, it tries to do a kind of cleanup, and it's based also on the Vulkan one, but it's slightly different. It adds new features, more OpenGL friendly, and removes some of them. So, curiously, again, just GLSL through SPIR-V is not suitable for OpenGL consumption in this case. It's somewhat confusing. I will talk about that somewhat later. So I'm going to, as I said, this presentation is update. So I'm going to do a summary of what was the previous status on the previous presentation. So on Thursday, sorry. So on Thursday, around February, I think, what we have is that Mesa already had a way to, well, I'm talking about presentation on Forden, but this work was started the year before by Nikolai Handy. So what we have is that Mesa already has a way to consume SPIR-V thanks to the SPIR-V to NIR pass. NIR is one of the intermediate representations that Mesa has. Internally, Mesa use IR, NIR, TGSI, etc. I don't remember how many, etc. there are, but I think that there are at least one or two more. The problem of that is that the shader linking was based on IR. So the first workaround was a kind of partial conversion to IR. They took the variable defined at NIR and converted to IR. And they tried to do some, they call that shadow variables. That was really useful for the bootstrap to start and to get something done, but was discarded soon. At that point, we had a first proof of concept and good enough to pass all the CTS tests. If you don't know, the CTS is the conformance test suite that is used to get the official certification from Khronos if your driver is OpenGL 4. Whatever. So from this proof of concept, it was cleaned up, and a downstream version was used by Intel to pass the conformance test. The challenge here is that at that point we decided that what we needed for IRB GLSPIR-V was a new linker based on NIR. The main reason, the main difference between GLSL and SPIR-V was the lack of names. So in GLSL, most of the leaking rules and how things are related with other things are based on the names. So a UBO has a name, and in one stage has this name, and the other stage needs to be the same name. And if you have a variable, the uniform is a combination of the UBO name, and if it's an array, well, et cetera, et cetera. So for example, at the end of the slide, there is a quote from the GLSL linker that basically says that it's using a hash table to link the UBO, and it's using the UBO name as key. And obviously, if it's using a hash table, that means that it's going to ask for the hash table several times. But as on SPIR-V, we don't have names, because on SPIR-V, names are consider the book information, and optional, that is, we can reuse that. So, devolution. And for this part, I decided a frequent asked questions format, because basically when I was writing the presentation, I was focusing on, okay, what people will ask the insights about all this work. So, I decided to made all the work for them and made the questions and the answers. So the first question, for them was on February, we are already on September, so a lot of time has passed. So are we regretting this decision? No. In fact, during all this time, during the development, we started to find more difference between between the GLSL linker and what this new extension requires. Specifically, we started to find that there is, although in general, the idea is using the SPIR-V modules being as more OpenGL as possible, there is some specifics that are done in the Vulkan way. For example, the memory layouts of UBOs and SSBOs. On OpenGL, there is a list of available memory layouts, STD-140 and STD-430, for example. But in Vulkan, you don't have that. You have explicit strides and explicit offsets. And here we have the same. So for example, that part of the code that we had on GLSL in order to compute the buffer size based on the memory layout was gone, and it needed to be re-implemented. So, but again, some people will wonder, but why not extend the shadow variables idea? Why not a kind of near to IR pass? Again, we will still have the problem of not having the names. Excuse me. The GLSL linker is using the names as a reference. So, in my opinion, as probably other people will not agree with me, even if we have a SPIR-V to IR pass, I really think that most of the code, it would be better to be implemented in a different place. I mean, okay, reusing the utilities, the visitors, etc., that we have are available, but probably not integrated with the code that's already existing, because there is a lot of difference. Another question. Why not make up the names and go with the IR linking? But then we will have the question, and how we make up the name? I mean, we use a kind of the binding, we have the location. The thing is that it depends on what you are linking at that moment. You will need to use the binding, or you will need to use the offset. And that will start to be a mess. In specifically, you will mean that you are losing the semantics. You are losing that what you are using at that moment to do the linking. And in fact, the specification of this extension encourages you to link using the Vulkan way. That is using the built-in decorations, the locations, etc. And making up a name just sounds hacky. It's hacky too. And this is a question that sorry. And this is a question that Timothy Ashery made during the review process. He thought that the linker that we were creating, that we were writing, was too tailored, too specific to this extension, and he was wondering, but why not use this moment to start a GLSL linker based on NIR, so in the future we could remove one of the intermediate languages. Again, I'm repeating myself, the problem is that a GLSL linker will need to be based on the names. So even if we implement that, a GLSL linker based on NIR, it will be really different to the linker that we are writing now. In fact, initially at the project, we started trying to reuse as much code as possible, to add abstractions in order to reuse on a future near-based linker for GSL, etc. And what happened at that time is that we were doing weeks just thinking on abstractions, just trying to look at the code, and nothing was advancing. So we decided to just focus on the problem that we have. And I say problem, the problem is that we didn't have implementation for this. And we still think that the difference that we have on GSL and on this extension justifies having a new linker, a different linker. Obviously, we still try to share as much as possible, but what we are sharing is just utilities like accessors to the NIR, iterators, something like that, not the linking utilities. Okay, but still, some people will wonder, but why is it taking so long? Isn't SPIR-V somewhat more straightforward? Isn't the idea behind SPIR-V to remove a lot of the usual linking and be more direct? The thing is that in the end, what we are needing to do is filling up the internal structures that Mesa have. For example, the uniforms need to be enumerated from the UBOs. In order to know how many uniforms we have, we also need to compute information related with uniforms and other variables, for example, the buffer size and all that stuff. So some people will wonder, but hey, number of uniforms, buffer size, but isn't the idea behind the SPIR-V to not having introspection? That is not inherent to SPIR-V. That is how Vulkan, that's the Vulkan way. The Vulkan way is basically you cook your food. I mean, if you have a UBO and you need to compute the size, I mean, you know the UBO, you compute your size, fill with data, and just give us. We are not going to do your job. That is not the case here, because here is the, as I said before, the idea is being as more OpenGL as possible. But some people will say that there is a lot of reference on the spec that says no reflection required. That's true. On the spec, there is an issue that says that first we will start with our reflection, and then there is another issue that says no reflection required. But those issues, and when they say no reflection, they are talking at that moment about non-name reflections API. They are talking about what happens when you don't have the names. So they are just explaining that as there are no names, you don't need to provide reflection. But on a different issue, it says it really clearly. Allow as much as possible to work naturally. Naturally, I mean, you need to interpret what means naturally. You can query for the number of active resources and for the details about them. Anything that doesn't query that name will work as expected. So, for example, if in your application you have an UBO, you can query for the size of the UBO because you have the binding. So now it's the bummer. I mean, so that means that we need to implement everything that the GLSL linker has? No. Well, fortunately, no. Here the scope is really smaller. As I mentioned before, the both extensions define the GSL that we can use, remove a lot of features, meta cleanup, and at the same time, in a similar way to Vulkan, we can assume that the SPIR-V has been already validated. So a lot of the validation rules are not needed to be implemented. In fact, some will be needed to be implemented. It's not really, at least to me, it's not really clear how many, but that simplifies a lot. And as I mentioned before, here we don't have specific memory layouts. We are using strides, and that makes computing the buffer size more simple, because it's basically using the strides, using the basic type sites, and multiply. So, testing. The thing is that this extension provides a new way to load a shader, and it's expected that most of the features from OpenGL will need to be working. So this needs a lot of testing. Because as I mentioned before, that the CTS, that we have been passing the CTS tests for a long time, that's not enough. The CTS test were focused on testing the specifics of the extension. The new things that the extension bring, just a shallow test of executing a shader. So we decided to use Stencilit Piglet. Piglet is a test suite for OpenGL that is probably the most popular one, the most used one for Mesa developers. And several of their tests are run by a tool called ShaderRunner. ShaderRunner uses a test format for the shader, for this test. This test includes the shader source, the data values, or the expected values. This is an example that probably you are not going to be able to read because the letter is really small. Sorry for that. But what you are seeing here is a first block about what the test requires. Then some blocks with the shader source on GLSL shader. And at the end, what the test is doing. It renders, it tests the clear the screen, and do some verification, like for example, that the number of uniforms are 1, 2, whatever. And he draws some basic shapes, like reds. And then it checks what is the value on the color value of that rendering. So, as I mentioned before, this work was started by Nikolai Hanley. I probably mispronounced his surname. And he also provided support for Piglet. He provided support for, on the previous test that I showed, the ability to include the SPIR-V shader. He also provided a script that takes the test and passes it to GLSLang. GLSLang is a tool created by Khronos, or at least maintained by Khronos, that translates from GLSL to SPIR-V and also provides some additional tools. And right now is the most mature tool for doing this conversion. Some attempts were done to add that on Mesa, but are on hold right now. So with this support, what we are doing is, as we are implemented, we are adding some bare-bone tests in order to test what we are adding. But that's not enough. So what the scripts do is also trying to reuse tests that were not writing for other specifications. In some cases, it even tries to do some fixing. For example, the GLSL needed for GLSPIR-V is assumed that we'll have explicit locations, explicit bindings, etc. So the script what try to do is, if you don't have that, just adding the explicit location for the ins and the outs, and also for the uniform. It also has several utilities, like for example, automatic filtering of tests that are not compatible with GLSPIR-V. And we got a lot of tests this way. This allowed us to work based on doing a test-based implementation size basically day zero. And since then, we improved and change a lot of the script. In fact, some of the fixing that the script was doing, we moved that to GLSLang. GLSLang were also trying to do those fixes, so we decided to go to simplify the script as much as possible. In fact, as part of our development, we were fixing some GLSLang bugs. Our policy was that was not the priority, so what we were doing is, if we find a bug, if it is easy, we try to fix. If not, we create an issue. Fortunately, GLSLang is a well-maintained project, so we got some of our fixes integrated, some bugs fixed by others with a different solution, and also some issues that we just opened and described and the maintainer fixed that. In any case, we still are using our downstream version of GLSLang, and around 40, 50 tests depends on that. So, what are the conversion numbers that we have? So on Piglet, there are two kinds of tests. One are the handwritten tests, and the other are the genetic tests. So if we take the 2,000th handwritten test, we are getting more than 1,000 tests. And for the 30K genetic tests, we are getting around 30K tests. That means that just borrowing tests from other specifications, we are getting not free, but easy, 30K, more than 30K tests. That in fact, as initially we made a kind of, okay, we need to do this, this, and this, let's do that. At some point, we just moved to test bases. I mean, we listed all the tests that were failing, we made a triaging, we started to fix bugs. So, okay, this is the conversion numbers. This is how many tests are converted to SPIR-V. So now, if we do a run of all the shaders, right now, with our development branch, we get almost 30K test passing. It's little over 100 test failing and 11 crashes. Most crashes came from because we still need to implement multidimensional UBOs, SSBOs. Most failures came from missing validation checks. So somehow that means that if the shaders are correct, more of this other space will go out. In fact, as I mentioned before, this spec points that for an individual module, the SPIR-V needs to be validated. So it's really likely that several of those fails will be just skipped too. So the current status, what do we have on master? As I said before, we have been working almost for a year, so we have something on master, yes. We have around 80 Mesa patches and around 30 patches on Piglet. So now that I'm here, thanks to all the reviewers, especially to Timothy Arcery, that he was focused on the linker, and to Jason Extrand, that was based on NIR and the SPIR-V part. And right now, that covers basically uniforms, atomic counters, transform feedback, geometric streams, 64 bits and vertex attributes, and some etc. What's happening now? What we are working now directly? I mean, this week, we send a series of 26 patches that provide the support for UBO, SBO, except the multidimensional arrays. And this support and some extras. And those extras, we added those extras mostly because we were in a position that we were almost passing all the CTS tests. And that was a fine checkpoint. So that means if this series gets reviewed and approved and merges on master, that means that master will pass the conformance test for this extension. So what's next? What's next on things that needs to be done? As I mentioned before, the introspection, the queries needs to work. But the problem with that is that we didn't have too many tests for that. I mean, Piglet has tests for that, but are not based on shader runners. So most of the work that we are doing that here are done on the testing. And then most of the features on Mesa are null checks, because the problem is that everything needs to work without names. So before that, everything needs to have names, so we need to add a lot of null checks. The other thing that we need to add is multidimensional UBO, SBO. In fact, this got delayed because the thing is that on Vulkan, this is not needed. So we needed to clarify with Khronos if we needed to do that on OpenGL. It was funny because one of the answers was, but this should be needed to be supported on Vulkan too. So they needed to have. In fact, this was not resolved until a face-to-face meeting, as far as I remember. On the face-to-face meeting, the conclusion was, on Vulkan you don't need this, but on OpenGL you need that. And at that point, most of the UBO, SBBO support was done, so we decided to clean up what we had, send to review, so this is still pending. The other thing that we need to add is more validation. Also, it's true that for individual module, the SPIR-V needs to be correct. There are still some specifics that needs to be validated, or at least expected to that the driver will check that. And after that, unless we are forgetting something, after that and some fix, some bugs, we will need to start a debate about enable the staging or not. And I think a debate because the thing is, as I said before, the thing is that with this extension, you will be able to run whatever shade that you want, a lot of features, and we are only testing with the Piglet test that uses other test. So I think that some debate will be needed. In any case, for a long term, other things that we need to provide is shader cache support. Right now, we have some crashes and some false positives related with the shader cache. So it was not mandatory. It was a really good to have, but not really mandatory. Right now, it's disabled for this extension. We just disabled that, and the cache is not used. In fact, right now, as far as I remember, the cache on Mesa is called GLSL cache. So that will need we will need to do some work there. Other good to have thing will be bring names. The thing is that right now, as the names is optional, even if the SPIR-V shader has names, we are ignoring them. We are not getting them. And I guess that at some point, if people started to use that extension, we'll say, hey, where are my names? So we will need to bring them. And also test or implementation with a real application. Unfortunately, the thing is that this extension is so new that we don't have so many applications using this extension. In fact, Timothy Arsari, when we were talking about this work, he said that he was okay with reviewing the patches because he's interested on this extension getting done, but he's not doing real work on that because he doesn't find any game or application using it. And now, I mean, when I was writing the presentation, I started to have some thoughts that I would want to say. Now that I've written that, they sound like a rant. I hope that's not the case. So, some personal thoughts related with this. One of the things that I found of this extension is that it's trying to get the best of the two worlds. It's trying to get SPIR-V on OpenGL. SPIR-V is, it's a new shading language. It's cool. It's used by Vulkan. But at the same time, it's trying to use everything in the OpenGL way, trying to use as much OpenGL as possible. But sometimes I feel that what we are getting are the worst of the two worlds, because the thing is that, yes, we are getting SPIR-V, but SPIR-V is, the names are not mandatory. But at the same time, OpenGL needs to do basically the same linking that Vulkan. I mean, the Vulkan linking is really, really more simple when they are dealing with SPIR-V. And we are getting more work only to support a subset of the OpenGL introspection APIs. So sometimes I feel that it should be better to just trying to make things in one of the ways. And I understand that it depends on how do you plan to use this extension. One way to that is planned to use this extension is a kind of helper that when you are trying to port your application from OpenGL to Vulkan. And the other way to use this application will be if you have an application and you want to render it, OpenGL and Vulkan, you want to use this extension to use just one set of shaders. So on the first one, on the porting, I think that making things on the OpenGL way makes sense. But on the other one, about that, I still think that will be the more common use case for this extension. I think the Vulkan way of things will be more sensible. And related with that, the other thing that I found here is this GLS confusion. I mean, I understand that you want to refine the GLSL that you want to use for this to feed SPIR-V, to translate from GLSL to SPIR-V. But what I found confusing is having two different extensions to define that. Because this extension, at least when they are describing what the frontend needs to support, reference the Vulkan extension as the base, but listing the changes. And there is I found that there are too many features switching and changing. The thing is that, for example, one extension removed one feature, and the following extension added that feature back. As I said before, if the use case of this extension, if one of the use cases of these extensions is allowing the same application to have two renderers, then they will have the problem that they have one extension defining what is the original GLSL supported, and other extension for OpenGL defining what GLSL is supported. So that means if it is confusing for the driver developer, I think that will be also confusing for the applications. All this sounded like a rant, sorry for that. I was just trying to analyze some of the things that we found when we were developing this. So now closing, yes, I'm closing. So who were working on this? This is, as I mentioned before, this was started by Nikolai Hanle. I don't know how to pronounce that surname, from MED. Then it was continued by Igalia. I have been working on this from the beginning, except a small break for my parental leave. But we also have some other people from Igalia, Antia there, Edu there, and some others, and Neil Roberts. This work I supported by Intel, so I'm here, and I will use this moment to thanks for the support. And that's the end. So, any other question?
Questions? Okay, it seems we are speechless. Thank you very much, Alejandro.
You're welcome.